is said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Beloved, that's why we have come together at this 9:30 hour, to worship, to praise, and to lift up the name of our God. I'm so excited and elated that you have decided to join us in this worship encounter. And it is my prayer that you are blessed by the word, by the music ministry, by the worship experience, and by the fellowship of the saints. If you're in virtual spaces and you would like to know more information about our church, please visit our website, www.pinegrovembc.org. Once again, let me take this time to welcome each of you. Let's go into worship.
Come on, bless the Lord, Pine Grove. Can we bless the name of the Lord this morning? It's a celebration. We came to celebrate our risen Savior. He's worthy. Listen, it's an exciting time because we get to celebrate our servant who has been serving the Lord for 14 years. Listen, can we give it up for our servant this morning? It's a blessing to be in ministry, to continue to do the work of the Lord. Listen, I don't know about you, but I'm feeling very blessed this morning, particularly blessed because I know that he woke me up this morning and he started me on my way. He gave me some food to eat. He gave me some gas to drive over here. That's enough to be able to bless him. Can we bless his name together? Listen, won't you do me a favor? Look at your neighbor. Look at your neighbor. Say, I am blessed. No, that's the wrong neighbor. That's the wrong neighbor. Look at your other neighbor. Say, I am blessed. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Listen, if all the blessed people can just stand up together to worship his name together, we bless his name, for he's worthy. Everybody clap your hands like this, real strong. Two. Come on, it's a time to bless his name.
Let me hear you say I am blessed.
I am blessed.
Do you feel blessed today, church? Amen. We are blessed to be here. If you are sitting in the sanctuary or online today viewing with us, you're blessed. Amen, somebody. And let me tell you, we are particularly blessed today because we are celebrating our pastor's 14th anniversary. Amen, somebody. Come on, y'all. So at this time, I want you to stand to your feet, church, because our pastor, the Reverend Dr. C. Germaine Turner, our First Lady, Sister Antoinette Turner, the three beautiful children, Minister Chance, Christian, and Jacob, are on their way in. And I want you guys to give them a glorious, thunderous welcome this morning. Amen, somebody. We thank God for our pastor. Amen. Our First Lady and our beautiful family. Amen. 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 I thank you, Pastor Turner, First Lady Antoinette, and all of the children. We thank God for you this morning. Amen. That we're celebrating your 14th anniversary. Praise God. Thank you for your teaching, your preaching, and your leadership. Amen. You may be seated. This morning, as we celebrate, I thank God for the opportunity to serve, to stand here this morning on our pastor's 14th anniversary. We want to make sure that you celebrate with us by lifting your voices of praise to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ today and giving our pastor and our First Lady a handshake, a hug, a thank you. Amen. Amen. On our program this morning, we have a prayer by Minister Parker, which will be followed by the reading of a litany by Minister Nathaniel Broadnack. And then we will have a welcome by Sister Stewart. But before then, I would like for us to recognize any visitors that we might have today. I would like to ask you to stand. If you are a first-time visitor with us today, will you please stand this morning? Let us recognize you. Amen. Amen. We thank you. We thank you for visiting with us today. Now, if you are a returning visitor, we want to see your face too. Will you please stand? Amen. Amen. In our balcony. Amen. Thank you. Thank you for returning and visiting with us on this special occasion today. We have a special visitor among us this morning, Sister Marilyn Littlepage. Will you please stand? She's returning home. Here she is back here. Thank God for you this morning. We thank God for your presence. Our announcements this morning is to keep our sick and shut in prayer. Continue to lift up our sick and shut in and our bereaved. We ask that you pray specifically for Brother Humphrey, for Sister Dolores Ellison, and will you please lift up Sister Petra Johnson this morning. Her father passed away, who lives in Germany. Amen. Also remember Sister Eleanor Webster, who is hospitalized in Athens, Alabama. So continue to lift those folks up in prayer, if you would, please, today. And before you leave, honor God with your offering. Amen, somebody. And if you would like to give our pastor a love offering, you can place it in a wooden box in the foyer. So as you leave today, you may bless our pastor by honoring him with something from your heart in a box that's placed in our foyer. Amen, somebody. So also this morning, we are excited to introduce our guest speaker for this morning. It is our guest speaker is Pastor Antoine Green, and he is a pastor, founding pastor of New Life Church in Athens, Alabama. New Life Church is first started its first worship celebration on June 4th, year 2000. And God has blessed New Life with great growth in all facets of ministry. Some of the projects that he has done is that he has authored three books. One of the books is called A Closer Walk with God, One Day at a Time. However God chooses, he may not do it your way. And The Decision, My Head Versus My Heart. Pastor Antoine Green is also a co-author of a book with his sister, Dr. Andrea Wilson, which is called When Ministry Meets Medicine. He has participated and served on the board of Limestone County Department Human Resources for 10 years, and he is currently the Director of Christian Education for Alabama Full Gospel Baptist Church Fellowship. His personal achievements is that he's married to the former Felicia D. Batts of Huntsville. They have three beautiful children, Jasmine, Caleb, and Imani. He graduated from the University of Alabama in Tuscaloosa with a degree in broadcast journalism. He is a former news anchor and a reporter for WBRC Fox 6 television in Birmingham, Alabama. So next on our program, we will have a prayer by Cornelius Parker, followed by a litany by Nathaniel Broadnax, and then our welcome. After the choir sings, you will hear from Pastor Anthony Green.
Morning. Can we bless the name of the Lord this morning? This is an exciting time. We came to bless his name, to give glory to his name, to give honor to his name, for he's worthy. Listen, we want to just take a quick moment and just bless the name of our God this morning. How many came to serve a worthy Savior who's worthy to be praised, who's worthy in all aspects of life? He's been able to wake you up this morning and get you going on your way. Listen, this song we're going to sing real quickly. I just want to get into your spirit. The song says, hallelujah, you're worthy to be praised. Can we say that together? Hallelujah, he's worthy to be praised. Look at your neighbor. Won't you do me a favor? Do a quick clap. Won't you stand up on your feet and worship together? Let's celebrate the goodness of the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, let's sing it out right here. Let's say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You're worthy.
You're worthy.
Sing it out. Say, I lift my
head.
And I praise you, Lord. Come on, we bow our heads.
I bow my head.
And I honor you, Lord.
I honor you, Lord.
One more time, say, I lift
my head.
And I praise you, Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Say, I bow my head.
And I honor you,
Lord.
Honor you,
Lord. Come on, let's say, hallelujah. He's been a worthy God. Sing and say,
hallelujah.
You're worthy.
Praise.
Say,
hallelujah.
All the way out.
You're
say, to be praised. Everybody, clap your hands like this. If you can, now bless a worthy God. Take a moment and think of his goodness. We celebrate his mercies. We give him all the glory.
Hallelujah.
He's worthy of the honor.
Hallelujah. You're worthy.
rejoicing. I don't know how you're feeling, but I believe the Spirit is moving into this place. Come on, I need you. If you're in a section, we want to get you to incorporate with us. This isn't just one person, but it's all of us united together to worship the name of the Lord. All my sopranos in the building. Sopranos, talk to me right here. Say, holla. Come on, soprano, sing it up. Church say amen. Come on, let the church say amen. Amen. All heads bow and all eyes close. Our Heavenly Father, and that is in heaven, Lord, we come at this present time foremost giving you praise and honor. For you're worthy to be praised. Oh, Heavenly Father, Lord, we give you praise, Lord, because there's no other like you. For you are a God that sits high and looks low. Oh, Heavenly Father, Lord, we say thank you, Lord, for what you have done and what you're about to do in this place. Oh, Lord, we thank you for our pastor and his family. 14 years, oh Lord. We pray that you keep them, oh Heavenly Father. Keep your loving arms wrapped around them, oh Lord. Protect them from all the danger and harms, oh Lord. And then, Lord, we say thank you again for being who you are and what you are. And that's our Lord and our God. Lord, the old saints used to say, if I had 10,000 tongues, I couldn't praise you enough. But since I have one, Lord, I said thank you, Lord, and hallelujah. And then, Lord, I say thank you for watching over us from Sunday to Sunday, hiding us from the enemy, even if the enemy lies within us. Oh, gracious Father, Lord, let us continue to worship you, continue to praise you, for you are a God of love, a God of mercy,
a God of forgiveness. And Lord, we just give you praise. And your sweet son, Jesus Christ. And let all the saints say amen, amen, and amen.
Recite litany of pastoral appreciation for our esteemed pastor, Dr. C. Jermaine Trump. Eternal God, from the foundation of the world, you formed and fashioned a man in your image. You called him a pastor. You gave him eyes like the sons of Issachar to discern the times and know what to do. You gave him ears like the prophet Elijah to discern your voice, even when you speak in a still small voice. You gave him a mouth like the ancient prophet Isaiah, whom you commanded to cry aloud, spare not, and lift his voice like a trumpet.
Thank you for a preaching pastor who declares the whole counsel of God.
You gave him a heart like David, a shepherd's heart to guide this flock with compassion and comfort. You gave him hands like Paul, the apostle who labored tirelessly to build your church and carry the gospel near and far.
Thank you for a hard-working pastor whose vigorous labor of love continues to bless us all.
Altogether, with one voice, we pray for your servant, Pastor Turner, a diligent laborer for the kingdom. Bless his life. Order his steps and give him clarity, boldness, stamina, and power for every work you have laid to his charge. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. Good morning. As we know, today we are celebrating our pastor, Pastor Turner, on his 14th anniversary. Can we get a hand? You know, you're looking kind of old over there. But I'm getting old too. 14 years. For 14 years, I've had a pastor. For 14 years, I've had also a mentor, a person who had my back, even though I don't always see him, I know he's there. For 14 years, I've had a place that I can call home, that I can come back to and raise my hands and praise the Lord, but also I can set my burdens down and all the things that happen in my life, I can lay them down right here. I've been to many a church where you go in and you say hallelujah and you leave, but I come here and I say hallelujah and I know that I have a family, I have a home. As you know, I'm getting ready to go off to school, and that's a scary thing. But I know that every break that I come back, that I have a home to come back to. And I like to thank Pastor Turner for 14 years of just a loving place, loving arms. His family, Mr. Chance right here. I remember, we used to be up in Sunday school back in the old church. We didn't even have all this. Man, but I just thank him so much. And not a day goes by where I don't appreciate having that hand behind my back, just knowing that I have somebody here that I can come back to. And I just like to say thank you. Everybody, give Pastor Turner a hand, please. Thank you.
Wasn't that beautiful? Give that young man a hand clap of praise. I got so excited this morning, I introduced the guest speaker. I asked the visitors to stand. And so now I will tell you that this is a confirmation that we are excited about today. Amen. Next, we will have a song by our choir, and then we will have our guest speaker of the hour. God bless.
listen, this is your time. I believe that if we have been able to make it through 14 years with our pastor, it's not by any of our works, it's not by any of his works, but it's only by the work of the Holy Spirit. And so the same spirit that is moving in him, the same spirit that's moving in this church, it's moving in this place right now. So I don't know what you may be in need of. I'm speaking to somebody in this moment that you can call upon the name of Jesus and he'll be able to send out his Holy Spirit. You just take a moment, take it for yourself, and just call upon his name. Hallelujah. Take a moment and bless him. Magnify his name. We call upon the Holy Spirit of God to move into this atmosphere because he's worthy. He's worthy. He's mighty. He's mighty. Come on. I need you to cry to say real quick. Come on, say Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
Call out to him. We say Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
Say, oh, Holy Spirit.
Oh, Holy Spirit.
He's moving in your life. He's moving in your family. Say, send your. To fall down.
We need to fall in this place.
Hallelujah. As we celebrate, the Spirit comes through. We invite the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in this place. Say, fall down.
Fall down.
We say, fall down. Last time, church, let's sing it out. Say, fall down.
Fall down, down.
Come on, church, can we take a moment and bless the Spirit of the Lord for moving in this place? We bless him, we bless him, we bless him, we bless him. We magnify him.
That are blessed and thankful, will you come on and put your hands together and give God a hand clap of praise in this place? I said, all of us that are blessed and thankful, will you come on and put your hands together and give God a hand clap of praise in this place today? We greet you in the name of God, the Father, our Creator, God, the Son, our Savior and Redeemer, God, the Holy Spirit, the Comforter and the Guide, and certainly the voice of our calling. As you probably know, I am not E. Jermaine Solomon. He is he. I am me. And we pray for him in this season. But we also celebrate this moment that we have to be able to come and share with my friend and my brother and my family. Certainly to the tears of leadership of the Pine Grove Church, we honor you and we thank God for all of you. And we thank God for my friend, my brother, your wonderful pastor. Can we take a moment and give God praise for Pastor C. Jermaine Turner? I said, can we take a moment and give God praise for Pastor C. Jermaine Turner, who has labored in the pastorate for 14 years, but has labored at Pine Grove even longer than that. And we thank God for him And while you're blessing him, can you bless God for his wonderful wife, my sister, Antoinette? We thank God for you. Amen. Amen. And can we thank God for my three nephews? Amen. We thank God for Jacob and Christian and Chance. We honor God and we thank God for this season. Certainly, Lady Felicia sends her love to you. She is in Louisville with our daughter in a travel volleyball tournament. And y'all excuse me if you saw me a few minutes ago checking my phone. They're in the championship bracket this morning, and I was getting updates. And mess with my spirit a moment because they won, but she missed two serves. So we're going to have to talk about that a little bit later on. But thank God for her. And I thank God for the privilege of being in the Pine Grove Church again. So many of our friends, so many of you that I've known, really on the flip side, many of you have known me since I was a little bitty boy. And we thank God for that. Pastor, the young man was kind of right in that he said he saw age on you. As long as our families have been intertwined with one another for many, 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 many years. And it's weird that Pastor Turner and I have always been close. His wife and my wife have always been close, like sisters. And his sons, particularly Chance and my son Caleb, have always been tight, and there was a day that we were younger. But Pastor, as my daughter loves to tell me, I've reached a point that my head is full of grandpa hair. The reality of my maturity and our maturity, Pastor, was when I was at the credit union the other day, and I was ordering some more checks, and the girl told me how much it was going to be, the charge to order the checks. And me being me, I raised Sam because I thought it was way too much for me to have to pay to order checks. But then, Pastor, she turned around and she said, "Wait a minute." I said, "Yes." She says, "You're over 50. I said, "And?" "You are now a senior, and you qualify for your checks free." I'm like, well, if it's gonna get me free checks. And then doggone it, Jermaine, I got the checks last week, and if on the each check it says senior class. I'm like, golly, well, we got time is filled with swift transitions. Amen. We thank God for you, and thank God for my leader sister, Michael Orr, for coming with us today. Michael, wave your hand. Thank God for you, man. I appreciate it. Listen, let's go straight to the word today, Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8. And I want you to fast forward to verse number 5. Acts chapter 8. And I want you to fast forward to verse number 5. And as you're doing that, can we give a great big amen for your wonderful music ministry that has blessed us today? Amen. Acts chapter 8, beginning at verse number 5. And when you have it, will you signify by saying amen? Here's what it says. It says, "Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria, and he preached Christ unto them." Verse 6, "And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did." Verse number 7, "For unclean spirits crying with a loud voice came out of many that were possessed with them, and many taken with palsies, and that were lame were healed." That's all that I want to read today. And if you will give me a moment for this time that is ours, I want to tag this text, "The Greatness of the Gospel." I want to talk about the greatness of the gospel. Pastor Turner, one of the most famous and one of the most popular songs of this time is the one that talks about God's goodness. And it says, all of my life you have been faithful. And all of my life you have been so, so good. And with every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Can I take a temperature check early in Pine Grove and just ask, is there anybody in this room that can say, regardless of all that I've dealt with in my life, I am a living, breathing, wonderful, testifying saint of God that can say, God has been, God is, and I believe God will be good to me. We measure goodness in different ways. Many of us measure goodness in our home, in our hood. Many of us measure goodness based on what we have. And many of us measure goodness by the commas and the degrees that postured behind our name. And those things are good. But then some of us measure goodness by the fact that the old deacon used to say, you laid me down last night in a mean, old, unfriendly world, and right early this morning, you taught my body with the finger of love. And so we see the goodness of God in every aspect of our lives, that we can see, that we can hear, that we can breathe, that we can be in this worship experience celebrating with pastor and people for 14 years of ministry. But may I suggest to us today in a preliminary way that the best way to measure the goodness of God is to assess and ultimately come to the knowledge of the things that God does that never has an expiration date. Out of everything that I have, everything that you have that is good, all of those things at some point will either expire, rust out, or wear out. Your wonderful little Lexus right now, at some point, your Lexus is going to wear out or rust out. Your wonderful home that you take so much pride in, at some point, it's going to have leaks and it's going to have cracks. It's going to have holes. And then even that body that we work so hard, well, some of us work so hard to try to keep in good shape and that we try to make look good. And then some of us will even pay to have accentuated and added to and taken from. At the end of the day, is there anybody in this room that can say, no matter what I do, the fact of the matter is my creaking knees and my aching back and this thing popping today that didn't pop yesterday, it is a living witness that I am deteriorating. So I think I need to put my hope and my trust on things that don't wear away and things that don't depreciate in value. And one of those things is the greatness of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This gospel has been around before you and I were. This gospel is still here with us now. And Chance, this gospel, even after it's all said and done, and we've given you the final rites, and this gospel is going to stay around forever. It's the one thing that I have in my life that doesn't wear out. It's the one thing that I have in my life that doesn't get old. It's the one thing that I have in my life that appreciates in value. And Pastor, I joked about it, but I've learned that the more gray hair that I have, the greater appreciation that I have for the gospel, because it lets me know that of all of my life, after everything that I've been through, the one thing that has remained solid is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Can I find about 39 people in this room that can say, I thank God for the gospel of Jesus Christ? We see the greatness of the gospel in this pericope when it backs up to Acts chapter 6, when there was the calling of the deacons for the church. Acts chapter 7, we see the whole discourse and dialogue when Deacon Stephen begins to tell the folks, tell the religious leaders. He tells them about this Jesus that you denied, this Jesus that you crucified, this Jesus that is resurrected. And y'all know how the story ended. Stephen ended up getting on the wrong side of the wrong people, and he ended up being stoned to death. And when we get to the end of Acts chapter 7, you will find he's stoned to death. And after he's stoned to death, Stephen, he tells them, Lord, lay this not to their charge. And as they are stoning them to death, they bring their coats and lay them at the feet of Saul. And then after they lay them at the feet of Saul, Stephen takes his last breath. Stephen dies. And the Bible says that when Stephen ended up dying, it says all hell broke loose in Jerusalem. Everybody began to scatter. And then Saul began to run wild like he was crazy, dragging people in and out of houses in the name of God. And then everybody is going crazy. And then we fast forward to chapter 8. And this is where I want to stop tonight. We stop at chapter 8. And when everything is going wild and everything is going crazy, that's when we begin to truly see the gospel at its greatest moment. And that's what I want to talk to us about. I want to have three things that I want to raise to you about the greatness of the gospel of Christ. If we look at these three things, it should let us be able to see just how great the gospel of Christ is. The first thing that I raise to you, y'all, come on, I only got three and I'm out. The first thing that I will tell you about this gospel is we ought to shout because it's all inclusive. Somebody shout, it's all inclusive. It's there in verse number 5. It says, then Philip went down into the city of Samaria, and he preached Christ unto them. Deacon Stephen has been killed. Deacon Stephen has been buried. Jerusalem is in turmoil. The whole people are scattered. Things are going sideways, Deacon Fletcher. And now God has an assignment for Deacon Philip. He has an assignment for Deacon Philip. And the assignment for Deacon Philip is, go to Samaria and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, this may not seem like a big deal to any of us. Well, first thing I would tell you, it is a big deal, Jacob, because number one, he calls Philip. He doesn't call an apostle. He doesn't call, y'all ain't talking, he doesn't call a prince. He doesn't call a king. He doesn't call the prophet, but he goes and calls a lay servant who is giving his life to serving to go and preach in Samaria. And I need to just talk to somebody here today. The work of the kingdom, it is not, thank God for Pastor Turner and his 14 years, but the work of the kingdom is not just for the pastor. It is not just for the preacher. It is not just for the deacon. It is not just for the key holder. It is not just for the title holder. It is not just for somebody that has power and prestige, but if it's for anybody in this room that has an Isaiah mentality, that says basically, Lord, if you can use anybody, you can use me. And I wonder, is there anybody in Pine Grove that can say the one thing that I want of God is I want him to use me in his service. So Philip is called to preach in Samaria. Number one, it's a big deal because of who he called. Then number two, Pastor, it's a big deal because at a time when the Lord wants to initiate revival for real, out of everywhere, he starts in Samaria. Let the church say Samaria. Samaria. Understand Samaria. The Samaritans, you would understand this is huge when you understand the belittlement, the shame, the scorn that was heaped on the Samaritan. Just huge when you understand the toxic relationship between Jews and Samaritans. Samaria. That is the northern part of Israel that About 750 years before this, the Assyrians had invaded and they captured and they conquered. And once they captured and they conquered this area, the upper class Jews and the middle class Jews and the elite Jews were basically deported, and they left town, and they left the poorer Jews and the ones that had no lineage and the ones that had no resources. Then pagans moved into the area, and then all of a sudden you had them that began to cohabitate, and they began to relate with one another to the degree that the Sumerians, they were believed to be the lowest of society. They were believed to be the scum of the earth. In fact, even the apostles, before the Lord really started talking to them, said they should have been burned before judgment. The Samaritans, they were called half-breed. The Samaritans were called half-breeds. They were believed to be dirty. They were believed to be unfit. They were believed to be unclean. They were believed to be unworthy. They were believed to be nobodies in the sight of everybody. But look at God in the place where the nobodies were, in the place of the people that had been disconnected and disenfranchised. That's when God wanted to start the revival. And the reason that this is noteworthy is because there are people even in this room and in the body of Christ. You may not live in Samaria, but there are people in this room that people have counted you out, that people have said you're going to be nothing, that people have said that you don't look like us, you don't talk like us. They said that your mom and him wasn't about nothing, your dad and him wasn't about nothing. You ain't going to never be nothing. But I came to tell you, just like in this text, it does not matter where you came from. God has not forgotten about you. I guess I just need to tell you, everybody is somebody with God. They call these folk half-breeds. May I say to you, I don't care who conceived you or the circumstance of your conception. Since God brought you here anyway, you have life and you are somebody in God's sight. Y'all ain't talking to me. I came to tell you, whether you're living large, you're big balling, shot calling, you're living your best life, you're driving and you're whining and you're dining, or whether you're just living and you're barely making ends meet and your ends are not meeting, they're not even in the same zip code. Whether you have a lot or a little, God told me to tell somebody, you're still somebody. It doesn't matter your skin color, black, white, you are somebody. And y'all know, Jermaine, how funny we can be, even the subset of your color. If you're white, whether you're ivory or clean or cream. If you're black, whether you're mocha brown, caramel brown, paper sack brown, or jet black. At the end of the day, God made you. And you don't let people belittle you for who you are. Will you do me a favor? Look down your road, tell them, I am that I am. Whatever it is, my lips are how they are. My color is how they are. I live where I live. But at the end of the day, God has still got me. It doesn't matter your relationship status. Been married 50 years. You freshly booed up with a new boo and a new bae, and y'all kicking it. You're killing it at Connor's every week, looking like a power couple. Or you may be divorced and determined, or you may be single and saved. At the end of the day, God ain't looking at all that. He's looking at where your heart is. And he is not forgotten you. I need to find somebody that can shout in here that can say, I'm so glad that when people counted me out, God didn't. I'm so glad when people put me down, God didn't. I'm so glad when people turned their backs on me, God didn't. I'm so glad that when people said I'd never be anything, God saw the best in me. And now I am something. The greatness of this gospel is that it's all inclusive. And the greatness of this gospel, Pastor, is that it is the Word of God. Somebody shout the Word of God. The Word of God, it addresses all of my issues. The Word of God, it will comfort me. The Word of God, it will convict me. The Word of God, it will correct me. The Word of God will direct me. The Word of God will discipline me. Somebody shout about the Word of God. The Word of God, it is the expression of God, because when I read the Word and I hear the Word, it's as if I'm hearing the voice of God and the heart of God. But not only is it the expression of God, it is the essence of God, because John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and then the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Is there anybody here that's happy that out of everything that God has given you, He loves you enough to include you to where the Word of God can speak to every situation in your life? The Word of God will tell you that He loved you so that He sent His Son. The Word of God will tell you that God looks on the inside when man looks on the outside. The Word of God will tell you that He has a plan for your life, thoughts of good and not of evil, to bring you to an expected end. The Word of God will tell you that everything that God does in your life, it is good. And God did. Is there anybody here that can say, if I don't have anything else, I celebrate the Word of God? All right. Pastor, they don't get it. Let me try this. I'm growing up. Some of y'all know, Pastor, growing up back in the day, there's a deacon. There's a deacon back in our area, a deacon named Deacon Don Patton. Don Patton. And I always used to love to hear Don pray. And when Don would pray, any of you have ever seen Don, he would come to the altar chance and he would pray. And then as the prayer was starting to come to an end, he would get up and walk back to his seat. And then, but as he walked back to his seat, he would always grab his ear. And then he would always holler, I got your word, I got your word. Now, when, Pastor, I got to admit, when I was young, it was funny. When I was young, it was funny because anytime Don would pray, we'd start nudging each other, talking, here it come, here it come. Watch this. And he would get up off the altar and start walking back to his seat and hold his ear, talking, I got your word. But then, Pastor, I messed around and I got gray hair. Pastor, I messed around and I got married. I messed around and I had children. I messed around and I got a boy driving from Birmingham now. I messed around and had a heart problem. I messed around and had death in my family. I messed around and had to bury grandmothers. And I messed around and had to preach loved ones' funerals. And all of a sudden, it ain't funny no more. I understand what Don was saying. He was saying, when I ain't got nothing else, I can stand on the word. When I have nothing else to turn to, I can stand on the word. When nothing else will fill me, I can stand and hold the word. I wonder, is there anybody in Pine Grove that can throw up both hands and say, if I ain't got nothing else, I got the... Do me a favor, look down your row, tell them this is the word row. This is the where we trust in the word. We have faith in the word. We believe in the word. We stand on the word. We shout about the word. And you need to just be shouting now that you have a pastor that comes every single solitary week and he gives you nothing but the...
So, the greatness of the gospel is that it's all inclusive. I told you I only got three. Here's number two. The greatness of the gospel, Margie, the message is simple and clear. Somebody say it's simple and clear. Watch the text. The text says, Philip goes to Samaria and he does a simple yet powerful thing. The Bible says he preached Christ. I'm going to try it one more time. He goes to Samaria and he does a simple yet powerful thing. He preached Christ. And that is so important in today's church. Because not here at Pine Grove, but there are a lot of places where a lot of buffoonery, clowning, and entertainment is happening in the walls of the church. And watch this. We slap the name of Jesus on it without the power and the anointing of Jesus being in it. He preached Christ. Now, I'm all for church being relevant and relatable to people. I'm all for our church meeting the needs of people in the community. Church needs to meet the needs of the people in which it serves. Can we agree? Every church ought to have strong evangelism and strong outreach program, because the fact of the matter is there are people out there that are never going to come here if we don't go out there and get them. Talk to me if you will. Every church needs a financial literacy program, because especially our people, we need to know that there is power in building wealth. We need to know there is power in land ownership, power in real estate. We need to know that we need to be building an inheritance to leave to generations to come. We need to know that we don't spend everything that we get. We need to know that there is a responsible way to manage credit, in which it makes a difference when you go to make major purchases and you are able to sit at the table with people that you would not be normally able to sit. We need financial literacy so you won't go buy a 12-year-old car at 39% interest paying $900 a month. We need that literacy. Are y'all here? We need ministry for Gen X and Gen Z and the millennials. Because I don't know if y'all do. I got a 29-year-old. I got a 21-year-old. And I got a 16-year-old. And they crazy. Y'all ain't talking. I know all of y'all's children so nice and they firm and they so strong and they all of this. But this generation, when I say that I love my kids, they are good kids, and I said it in jest, but the truth of the matter is this generation thinks differently than we do. This generation sees differently than we do. This generation hears differently than we do. And we can't force feed them what we do, because while we sit over here shouting or talking about we standing on the banks of Jordan, I respect that, but they don't know where the Jordan is. They ain't never seen no banks because they got a phone in their hand. We need that. We need marriage ministry, because people need to understand there's a difference between a wedding and a marriage. I wish y'all would talk to me just a little bit. We need to teach people that one is a celebration. The other one is a commitment. We need to teach people one is an event and the other one is a constant evolution, where we constantly learn one another and we constantly give and we constantly take. We need to teach what marriage really is. All of this craziness now, be married for 3 minutes, talking about we done for irreconcilable differences. No. What happened to grandmama and them that stood together through thick and thin and storm? We need to teach longevity in what the Lord brings together. Yeah. We need not only to teach the married people, but we need to teach the single and the saved. Because some people need to understand, and y'all hear me closely, you don't just need to have somebody on your arm to be having somebody. I don't care if she's fine. If she's draining you and causing you to go crazy, you don't need her. I don't care if he takes you out to dinner. You got a good job. Learn how to take yourself to corner. Sit in the corner. Get you a steak. If you want a little wine, drink your little wine. Enjoy yourself. Go home. Watch Lifetime. You don't have to put up with craziness. Stand still and wait on God to send them. Talking about, I don't know what's happening. You married the bride of Chucky. That's what happened. Talking about, I don't know what's wrong. He was Freddy Krueger before you said amen. Wait on God. We need to teach that. We need to have vision, for where there is no vision, people perish. We need to market the ministry because the world is saturated with things telling our people what to do, what to buy, where to go. You need to tell people what's going on at Pine Grove and how y'all are blessing and how y'all are changing lives. You need to do that. You need a media and virtual presence because most everybody today lives by the thumb. Sunday should be on fire. We need to shout. We need to holler. Choir needs to go get it. Preacher needs to preach like crazy. Sunday ought to be crazy. But at the end of the day, can I tell you something real quick? Regardless of what it is, the message ought to be simple and the message ought to be clear. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Simple message. There's no other friend like the lowly Jesus. Simple message. No, not one. Jesus, he knows all about. Okay, y'all heard that before. A message needs to be simple, and the greatness of this gospel is what we preach and what we teach, and I'm almost done. What we teach and what we preach, what we sing and what we worship, at the end of the day, it's got to have the simple message. It's got to fold and wrap around Jesus. If Jesus is not the center of it, then you don't have anything going on. If Jesus is not the center of the sermon, you got a speech, but you don't have a sermon. If Jesus is not the center of the song, you are singing, but you are not ministering. Everything has to have Jesus in the center of it. We have to have Jesus, the simple message. Anybody know the simple message? Jesus, the simple message. It is God himself wrapped in flesh. Jesus, the simple message. Y'all here with me? He is the Son of God. Give me half a finger if y'all know the simple message. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the Son of David. The simple message. Jesus is Messiah. Jesus is Messiah and the Savior. Simple message. He is the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. He is the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the earth. The simple message. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Y'all ain't saying nothing. The simple message. Emmanuel, God be with us. The simple message. He is the bridegroom. The simple message. He is the great head of the church. The simple message. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. The simple message. Y'all ain't saying nothing. The simple message. He is the good shepherd. He is the chief shepherd. And Bishop says, Peter says, he is the shepherd and the bishop of our souls. The simple message. He is the bread of life. He is the living water. He is the potentate. He is God. Anybody know the simple message? Simple message. And I'm going to find out if this is really a Baptist church. Simple message. Born of a virgin. Y'all be like, I hope he preaches. I'm preaching good. Simple message. Born of a virgin. Simple message. 8 days old, circumcised. Simple message. Age of 12 in the temple, asking and answering questions with the doctors of the law. Simple message. Bible goes silent for 18 years. It comes back on the scene at 30. Simple message. Baptized by John. Simple message. Heals, delivers, heals the sick, raises the dead for 3.5 years. Simple message. Betrayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. Simple message. He is convicted, arraigned, and indicted by a kangaroo court. Simple message. He died. Simple message. Not only did he die, but he died so good till the earth had a cosmic fit. Simple message. They took him off the cross, buried him in a new tomb. The simple message, that ain't the end of the story. Simple message on the third, y'all ain't talking. Simple message. So you don't want to preach Jesus? Same Jesus. Jesus will fix it. I can't hear. For you, whenever you pray, mother hearted, let him have his way. Jesus will fix. Sing Jesus, a way maker, miracle worker. Okay, let me try this one more time. If you know this, you will shout. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. Somebody shout, that is who he is. Okay, don't want to preach Jesus, don't want to teach Jesus, don't want to sing Jesus, just testify Jesus. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, my soul cries out.
Hallelujah. Yeah, God. Thank God for saving me. Pastor, the greatness of this gospel is as simple and clear. You got a James Cleveland spirit. Jesus is the best thing that ever happened to me. Pastor, it came to me. It came to me. Our Kojic friends, they do this little thing. They ask a question. They say, what do you say about Jesus? He heard it. In the Church of God in Christ, if you want to go have straight church, they just ask a question. What do you say about Jesus? Then everybody just start hollering, he's all right. Can I ask somebody in this section? What do you say about Jesus? Okay. Oh, God, please don't do it. Ah, God. Can I ask this section? What do you say about Jesus? Oh, okay. That section of it. What do you say about Jesus? Let me ask that side over there. What is it that you say about Jesus? Choir, can y'all help me, please? What do you say about Jesus? Okay. When you think, I want you to put on your thinking hat. Deacon Fletcher, put on your thinking hat. Think about this. The car was totaled, but you walked away. Doctor said it was over, but you walked in here today. You just about lost your doggone mind. But you woke up this morning with your mind stayed on him. I need to find the folk that can say, the numbers in my checkbook didn't make sense, but some way, somehow, my lights didn't go off, the tuition got paid, bills got paid, my car didn't get repossessed. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Well, let me appeal to a mother or a father. Your child been away from you. You know you raised them right, but the world is crazy. And you thank God that you hadn't got a call in the middle of the night saying that something. So now let me ask Pine Grove another question. What do you say about Jesus? You do me a favor. Look down your road. Tell him he's all right. Find three people. Tell him he's all right. So number one, the greatness of this gospel is that it's all-inclusive, and I'm out now. Number two, the greatness of this gospel is that the message is clear. It is simple and it is clear. Finally, I close today when I tell you that the greatness of this gospel is that it put God's power on display. When you read verses 6 and 7, says that Philip preached Jesus. And he says that the message moved the Samaritans and that they were on one accord. One accord literally meaning one heart, one mind, one heart, one mind, one passion. And it says they gave heed to the message, literally meaning they attended to it and they applied it. But Jermaine, they were really drawn after the message when the power of God came into the area and then miracles began to take place. And I just wanted to ask something real quick. Is there anybody here with your Baptist self that is willing to say this? I still believe in miracles. I still believe that God can do what doesn't make sense. I still believe that God can add by subtracting. I still believe that God can multiply by dividing. I still believe that God can create a door after closing a door. I still believe that God can do what doctors cannot do. Maybe that's what Grandmama meant when she asked the question, have you any rivers that seem uncrossable? Have you any mountains you cannot tunnel through? Come on and help me. Can I find 30 people that can say God specializes? Y'all ain't said nothing. Say God specializes in things thought impossible, and he can do what no other power can do. And so the power of God began to be on display. And the word of Jesus set the atmosphere for the work of Jesus through Philip. Two particular things happened in this text. Deacon Harden, he says, first of all, it says people that were possessed with unclean spirits. At the name of Jesus, all of these spirits started leaving the people. And I ain't tripping on getting professional help. I believe that professional help is necessary sometimes. I'm not tripping on you going through step programs, whatever it is, to try to get you where you need. But I do suggest this, that a lot of the problems that we have today, you can save a lot of money, you can save a lot of copay if you would just start inflicting and applying the name of Jesus. Because the greatness of this name is this, watch this. The devil resents it and the devil retreats from it. I'm gonna try it again. The greatness of the name of Jesus is that the devil resents it and the devil retreats from it. And so when we start really embracing and hollering and praying and singing and preaching the name of Jesus, the devil can't stay very long because it's just like backwoods off. It irritates him. And if I had a moment, I would tell you, that's why some of you who've now committed to God like you never have before, that's why some people are looking at you cross-eyed. That's why some of your company doesn't want to hang with you anymore. That's why they don't invite you to go eat anymore. Could it be that the Jesus in you is causing a reaction at the devil in them? We're Baptists. Some of us that are connected to Christ, surely you know the Baptist benediction. There are some jokers that the Lord is moving from your life because of the Jesus in you that you need to learn how to throw deuces to. Say, may the Lord watch between me and you while we are absent, one from another. But do it right. Say amen. Because at the end of the day, the demons can't stand where the divinity and the deity of Christ is present. The unclean spirits came. And may I suggest to us, and I'm done, if we don't cut loose bad company, if we don't crucify our flesh, if we don't speak positively, if we don't think positively, if we don't stay in the word, if we don't continue to worship, if we don't fellowship with the saints that are like-minded like us and want to go higher in him, the devil and his spirits. And y'all don't have to say amen, but I know it's true. The enemy can come strong and he can capture your thoughts. He can desensitize you in the spirit to where you are numb. He can destabilize you mentally and emotionally. The enemy can come and forfeit your peace and affect your actions. And he can leave you sleepless at night wondering, is God still God? But there's a solution. Philip preached Jesus. And the text says, demons fled. And not only did demons flee, it said people with the palsies were healed. Pine Grove, thank you. I'm done when I tell you this. A couple of weeks ago, Jermaine, guy, friend of mine, saw him in downtown Athens. He owns a lawn care business. And he says, Antoine, hey, how you doing? I say, hey, dude, how are you? He says, good. He says, I treated your dad's lawn the other day. I looked at him crazy because anybody that knows my daddy knows he ain't gonna pay nobody to come spray fertilizer on his lawn when he can go to the co-op. Y'all know the co-op is the solution to everything. When he can go to the co-op and get fertilizer and do it himself. I said, you went to my daddy's house? He says, yeah. He says, and he let me treat his lawn. I said, really? He says, I just done the neighbor's yard. Then I saw your dad standing outside, so I decided to walk over to him. And I said, Mr. Green, I would love to come over and to treat your grass. My dad, being George Edward Green, said, thank you for asking, but no, I'll do it myself. And then he said, I told him, I said, Mr. Green, you have some weeds coming up. I can put some pre-emergent out there to keep the weeds from continuing to grow. I can aerate your lawn so the rainwater and the fertilizer can get down to the roots. And Mr. Green, I'll do it all for $60. And then he said, my dad told him, no, that's all right. I'll do it myself. Then he says, well, then that's when I told him, thank you, Mr. Green. And by the way, next time you see Antoine, tell him I said hello. Then he said, my dad turned, and then he stopped. And he turned around. He said, do you know Twani? Now, y'all have to understand, Antoine Twani, that's what they used to call me back in the day. He says, you know Twani? He said, yeah, Mr. Green, we're classmates. We graduated together. Mr. Green, we played T-ball all the way through high school, baseball together. He's a really good friend of mine. My dad turned around, Jermaine, and then he says, he opened his wallet, took out a $100 bill, and said, go ahead and do my grass. Bill said he went on and did the grass, and he told him, Mr. Green, it's only $60. He says, no, 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 you go ahead and you keep all of it. Bill said he moved on to his next yard. But Dickon Fletcher, he kept on wondering, what was it that changed George's mind? He says, and then I got to thinking about it. He says, when I went and offered him to do it, he initially said no. And then he says, when I told him the great deal that I was offering, he turned around and said no. And then all of a sudden, he turns around and not only gave me the $60, but he turned around, Antoinette, and gave me $100. And he said, I still was trying to figure out what it was that changed his mind. And then he says, all of a sudden, it hit me. I was talking to a man who was a father. And I messed around and I called his son's name. And when I messed around and called his son's name, then all of a sudden, the father began to change his tone. And that's all I gotta tell you, Pine Grove, if you don't know anything else. May I suggest to you that you learn a certain name? Yes, the name I want you to learn, the Bible says it's a strong tower, and the righteous run in it and are safe. The name I want you to learn, the Bible says that this name, that every knee shall bow. Yes, and every tongue shall confess. The name that I'm talking about, the Bible says that there's no other name given under the heavens by which men might be saved. Is there anybody here that can sing, if I don't know nothing else, I know the name? I may not know Genesis from Revelation, but I sure not know the name. I may not know a major prophet from a minor prophet. I may not be able to list them in order, but I sure not know the name. I may not know Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, and Becca, Zephaniah, and Haggai, and Zechariah, and Malachi, but all I know a name. I heard Grandmama say, there is a name I love to hear. Sing his work. It sounds like music in my ear. It's the sweetest name on earth. Let the church shout, oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Do you know the name? He's Jehovah Jireh. He is our provider. He's Jehovah Rapha. Won't he heal your body? He's Jehovah Shalom.
Does there anybody here that knows the name of Jesus? Shout Jesus. Yes, Jesus. How I love to call that name. There's power in the name of Jesus. There's healing in the name of Jesus. Love in the name of Jesus. There's deliverance in the name of Jesus. Shout out.
Good Lord, better to us,
need to come off the program and praise him. Give him the praises that he deserves. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for your spirit. Thank you, Pastor, for your word. You move the spirit within me when you talk about Jesus. When you talk about Jesus. When you talk about Jesus. When you talk about that name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. And I just can't hold it in. I won't hold it in. I thank you, Lord. Yes, everything. There's power in the name of Jesus. And if you don't know it by now, as good as he's been to us, even if he woke you up this morning, God has been good to us. I would like for everyone to stand and the deacons to come forward as we extend the invitation to discipleship. Think about what's been said this morning. Jesus should be the center of what we know who we are. There's power in the name of Jesus. If there is someone who is with us today, and you want to know what all this screaming is about that's within me, I dare you to try it. I dare you to try it this morning. If something has been said this morning that has touched your life in any way, come this morning. Don't wait. Amen. Come. The God we serve, you need to get to know him if you don't know him. Amen. Amen. Come on down, young people. Amen. Amen. If you don't know him, come today. Don't wait. For tomorrow may be too late. Come on down. Amen. As they're coming, as Pastor says, you're clapping. Because we want to praise him. For it is God who is drawing you. Amen. We thank you for your word, Lord. We thank you for all that you've done in our lives. Amen. Amen. If you need someone to come and escort you down, we'll be happy to come and do that. We thank God for the word. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for being so good. You say your name.
Briley Davis.
Briley Davis, amen, this morning.
Everybody. Jamari Bates.
Jamari Bates.
Stephanie Bates.
Sanaya Bates. Sanaya Bates. We want to thank you all for coming forward today and allowing the Lord to lead you. These are all candidates for baptism. Do you believe that the Lord Jesus lived and died for our sins, and on the third day he was raised?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you believe that he is sitting at the right hand of the Father?
Yes, ma'am.
Our word tells us if you believe that he died for our sins and was raised on the third day, you are saved. Amen. Same question for you. Do you believe that the Lord died for our sins and on the third day was raised?
Yes, ma'am.
Our word tells us the same. If you believe in your heart and you confess with your mouth, you are saved. Do you believe that the Lord died for our sins and was raised on the third day?
Yes, ma'am.
The Lord said, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, you shall be saved. Same for you, young man. Do you believe that the Lord died for our sins and on the third day was raised?
Yes, ma'am.
Again, he said, if you believe in your heart, confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. And we are committed as a church to teaching and preaching God's word. And on behalf of Pastor Turner, we want to welcome you to Pine Grove. Amen. Church, what do we say? Amen. And then we're going to go with Brother Tucker and amen, church. Let's hear it again for our candidates for baptism. Amen. I thank you all for being here today. We are so excited about celebrating with our pastor. And at this time, I would like to introduce to some, and I want you to raise your voices and clap. And I even want you to stand for our pastor as he comes forward with remarks. The Reverend Dr. C. Jermaine Turner.
Antoine Green, if we're talking about we getting old, he didn't preach like it. Give it up for the preacher today. Come on, show him some love. Show him some love. Give it up for this choir who's blessed us today. This is the day the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad therein. I want to thank God for each of you, our Father's children, who have come out today to celebrate this 14th anniversary with us. And I am thankful unto God for being able to walk this journey, not only with the great people of Pine Grove, but with this beautiful family of mine. Amen. I want to thank God for Antoinette. Antoinette, stand up. You want to say something today? Did you want to say something? You said that Wednesday. You changed your mind?
Good morning, church family. Just wanted to stand to say thank you so much for all of your love, your prayers, and your support over these 14 years. I shared with the ladies a couple weekends ago that When we first came to Pine Grove 14 years ago, we were a family of one that quickly grew to, a family of three, which quickly grew to a family of four, and then very quickly grew to a family of five. So you guys have been with us through all of our life growing. We all grew up together. So we thank you for your love and your support. To my boys, I thank you so much for your support that you give and you show to me and your dad. To my husband, I say congratulations. And you don't stand alone. I stand with you, and the boys stand with us as well. It's your prayers, it's your diligence, and it's your commitment that I'm so proud of. And I love you.
I love you more.
Isn't she lovely?
Amen. Thank you, Antoinette. She is such an inspiration and a support. And I am who I am because of her. And I'm not ashamed to say it. She holds me together. Our three boys, Chance, Christian, and Jacob, you know, they really are. Tiffany is here. Tiffany, we were raised in a single parent home. And God bless my mom. Did the best she could. Thank God for my father and grandfather and grandparents, aunts, uncles. But as a child, I wanted to be a father who was there and who they could look up to, count on. We don't say it enough, but we're so proud of you. Daddy tough. Because what I understand is these are young men that will one day become men, have their own families. And parents, you understand we do the best we can, or we should. So I'm proud of every one of y'all. These three boys, they make me proud. Chance is preaching the walls down. I have to tell him, slow down. He ain't your, you know, get dad a little bit more time, you know. They used to call me Deacon Fletcher for me to preach, but now they call me to get Chance's number. And so I said, slow down a little bit. Christian is, he's our comedian. Chance and him told the kids they had to, upperclassmen had to find somewhere to go because dorms. And so we told Chance, hey, man, we got to find an apartment. So Chance got him in a little apartment. And the other day, Christian come through the house, Deacon Fletcher, and I saw my oldest baby in the house now. I said, you going to leave daddy? He looked, he said, I ain't never leaving. I said, who? I said, what? He's like, I ain't never leaving. I said, well, we'll talk about that a little later. And Jacob, all three of them, he's our baby. And we thank God for each of you. And we're proud of you. We want you to know that. Pine Grove has seen you grow up. And amen. We couldn't have asked for a better family to raise our family in. So I'm thankful for this immediate family. Our family, if you're part of the family, my family, stand up. I see my aunts. I've got two aunts right here and one aunt right here and an uncle right here. Amen. Y'all, stand up, my family.
Family. Come on, stewards. Come on. Stand up, this family. Where's my father-in-law at? Is he in here? Is he in here? Is he here? My father-in-law not here. He left. Okay, I got you. Listen, I thank God for my family. They are an inspiration and a support, and I praise God for each of them. You believe it or not, my best friend, Antonessa, who I talk to every day on the front row, Uncle Eddie, wave your hand, Uncle Eddie. We talk every day. And if I don't talk to him at least once a day, he gonna fuss. I said, we just talked yesterday. And so I want to thank God for them. Listen, real quick, and we're going to be gone. I was listening to one of my favorite preachers yesterday, Dr. Tellus Chapman. He was doing an installation for Pastor Mays. And Pastor Chapman said something that just resonated with me. He said that he did a revival. And during the revival, they took up a love offering for him. And he says that in preparation to get back on the plane, he wanted to put the money in the suitcase, so he went through it. And he said he got hundreds and fifties and everything. And he said there was one particular envelope that jumped out. He says as he opened the envelope, it was nothing in it. He says, but on the back of the envelope, the words forever blessed him. It says, I don't have anything to give you, but your word gave me life. And I want to thank God for Antoine. We're going to give you something. But your word today, I think, has given all of us life. Amen, somebody. And so we thank God for speaking to you, through you. Thank God for these deacons. Our deacons are the best, our official board. Deacon Sneed, it's good to see you over there. All right, Sage, spend some of his money, all right? And we thank God for all of those, even in virtual spaces. I came here 14 years ago, really 15, because Pastor McLathrop called me to serve as assistant before. God bless his soul. And there are so many people even who are in virtual spaces, i.e. the Ella Washingtons and the Eloise Chases, who served on our official board and have always been such a support system. And we thank God for each of them. Pine Grove, I am who I am because of your love and your support. And I want to thank you from the depths of my heart, because as Antoinette said, when we came here, we came as a young couple, all right? And you've walked along this life journey with me. I think Aiden is gone, but Aiden mentioned me as a mentor. And I want to, you know, tell him that I'm just paying it forward, because I am where I am because of the people like Manuel Wallace, who was in the school system. Amen. And from the first time I met him, I was able to look up to him because of how he carried himself, the Deacon Hardens and the Deacon Fletchers. And he was at Brother Drake's house yesterday, and Brother Drake has always been a mentor just based on how he carried himself. My grandfather was the best, and even people like Leroy Williams Jr., who was a mentor. And we are where we are because somebody else paved the way. I can't hear nobody. And so I want to thank God for all of those who have served as mentors, who are still with us, and those who are dead and gone. Pine Grove, listen, the best is yet to come. We're still walking this journey with the Lord. One of my good partners, Byron Blanks, in the back. Amen. Byron Blanks, I was a little boy, Uncle David, and I was trying to run with my first cousin, Adrian. And they about 4 or 5 years older than me, but they let me tag along. And me and Byron are now lifelong friends. And so I thank God for him and his lovely wife. And all of you, our fathers, I don't want to start calling names. Sister Harris, why are you not up here? You okay? Okay, I was worried. I said, Sister Harris, always in the choir stand. And so I'm glad to see you out there doing good, all right? All right, Pine Grove, would you stand to your feet? Pastor Green is going to come back. Let's show him some love. Yes, sir, Deacon. Take your seat, Deacon Fletcher. Take your seat, Deacon Fletcher, then show.
We won't hold you long. He wasn't ready to go. He acted. Thank you, Pastor Green, for that message, for the word. And you talked about the name, knowing the name. But I want to tell you, I know morning ain't. I know. Pine Grove, what you stand for? Just 1 second, Pine Grove. We have a little token here, appreciation for our pastor. I just want to let you know that this is all Pine Grove. So, Pine Grove, you included in this. You can go sit back down. Pastor Turner, I want to thank you for your really 15 years of service here at Pine Grove Missionary Baptist. We are a better church, better people came this way. We just want to say thank you. We can't pay you, but we want to give you a token to help you with these three boys. And I'm going to start from Mother Ann, and you just stand, you ought to stand. Dear beloved pastor, we're not paying you. Just want to say we thank you. May God continue to bless you and keep you. One more year.
Bless you, bless you. Deacon Fletcher is 91.
Wow.
90.
Wow.
I'm moving ahead, ain't I?
Wow.
Now, when I got here, okay, he told me I'm getting old. And I said, give me 15 more years. And so that's what he was referring to, the 1 year. But, you know, every year it sort of starts all over again. And he told me the other time, you don't know how to count.
You don't.
And so, Deacon Fletcher, 15 more years, and we're going to go ahead and get the benediction. I love you, man. I appreciate you. Come on, give God praise.
Once more, let's praise God for your wonderful pastor and his family.
I must say, Pastor Solomon had surgery, and he was not comfortable coming. And so I think he called me, when I called you, Tuesday? Wednesday? And he said, I'm not comfortable. And I said, man, stay where you are. And so you call a friend at the last minute. Amen. And they come through for you. Amen. And so I appreciate you, man. Thank you so much.
As I told you on the phone, the friends do what friends do. And as Pastor well knows, those of us who've been pastoring a minute, you just don't leave your church just to go anywhere at any time. But when this family calls, it's the least that you can do. And I do thank him. I do thank your pastor through the instance of a little bit over a year ago when I ended up having over a 99% blockage in the widowmaker artery of my heart. And I met with your pastor, and I'm like, man, for a while anyway, would you please let me use chance on occasion. And I know as a dad and as his pastor, that's a big ask, but I thank you that even now, I try to throttle it down some, and even now I'll call Chance fairly frequently and ask him to come. And Pastor, I appreciate you always allowing him to come. Mom, thank y'all. These are my guys. I am Jacob and Christian. I referee basketball. This was my 15th year, and I go to Westminster quite often. And the proof of the pudding of how a family is raised is when you see the children and the parents aren't around. And oftentimes I would be out on the floor, I see Christian coming in, look like he had just come in from workouts, all swole. And he'd always come up, Pastor, come out,
"What's up, Doc? How you doing?"
And I'm standing on the side baseline holding the ball. I'm like, "What's up, Christian? Me good." And then Jacob would come in with his camera taking pictures. And I remember the last time I told Jacob, I'm supposed to be getting ready to run down the floor. I said, "Make sure you get my good side." Jacob just fell out laughing for some reason. I don't know if that was indicating I don't have a good side or I got too many sides to pick. I don't know what that means. But Pine Grove, we thank you. We honor God for you. We speak blessings, life, wholeness, and favor over each every last one of you. All hearts and minds are clear. Let us stand at this moment. Over you, blessings over everything and everyone that is connected to you. And we pray that as you continue to walk in God, God will bless you in such a way that everyone will see the glory upon your life. It is so. In the matchless name of Master Jesus, let us all in this house agree and say amen.